First on BBC Two, the midweek Newsnight.
The battle to get the wraps off the sleaze report. It now looks as if we won't get Downey till after the election, but an interim report tomorrow. So what'll be published and who will be damned? Good evening. After a day of recrimination over whether or not to publish the Downey report, the Commons Committee on Standards and Privileges has tonight compounded the confusion by promising to publish tomorrow what it calls a partial report on the work it's completed so far. This followed a demand from all the opposition parties that the government should revise its timetable to allow the Downey report itself to be considered before Parliament is dissolved in 3 weeks' time. That's gutter politics, the Deputy Prime Minister fired back. But the Conservative MP at the centre of the sleaze allegations tells us he wants Downey published. So what do the Tories and Labour believe will be achieved by the apparent halfway house the committee now appears to be offering? Maurice Callaghan died of CJD, a year to the day since the government first warned of the links between BSE and the disease in humans. We take stock with the man whose report first sounded the alarm. The people of Brooklyn pay their last respects to murdered rapper Biggie Smalls. But was he actually killed by the music that made him famous?
So it's like this vicious cycle that we've become stuck in, and we see now, you know, Notorious B.I.G. and Tupac Shakur are dead because of all this posturing and stuff.
And the Prescott Express rolls in to launch Labour's campaign in Swindon. Is Labour's deputy leader such a loose cannon that some in the party prefer to see him as far as possible from headquarters in London? The row over the publication of the Downey investigation into charges that MPs were paid cash for questions has drowned a piece of news that might have been more of an electoral bonus for the government. Unemployment has dropped to its lowest level since a month before Mr. Major became Prime Minister in 1990. The count dropped by 62,800 to below 1.75 million. But the Tory press conference that was trumpeting these figures this morning was largely hijacked by questions about that sleaze report, the Downey report. Why couldn't time be found to publish it, people ask? Is this a cover-up, or has time genuinely run out on Downey? Well, we now know we are going to get something published tomorrow, but it's not entirely clear what. Anne Perkins reports.
It's a gift for the opposition at the start of an election campaign. A report into potentially the most damaging allegations a governing party can face, allegations of corruption. But they can't get at it because, they say, the Prime Minister's deliberately suspended Parliament early to keep it under wraps.
If the Prime Minister wants this issue to be published, this report to be published, to clear the name of some of his members of Parliament, to ensure that the electorate are properly informed when they come to vote for them, and I'm bound to say to him, clear the name of the government and the Conservative Party as well, let him say so.
It seems odd now that this report is then to be shelved as a result of that long campaign. There was a very specific promise made by Mr. Major last October, and he should simply keep to the promise and keep his word.
These allegations, I think to call them mischievous is a polite way of putting it. I think those people who made those allegations know very well that the Select Committee is independent and know very well that Sir Gordon reports to the Select Committee. And so does everybody who knows how the House of Commons works.
But damagingly for Mr. Major's case, he did say on television that he wanted the whole affair settled before the election.
It is very much my wish, my hope, and my expectation that this will be cleared up well this side of a general election. In everyone's interest, that should happen.
Neil Hamilton is at the centre of the affair. More than 2 years ago, he and a fellow minister, Tim Smith, were accused by The Guardian of taking cash through the lobbyist Ian Greer for tabling questions for Harrods owner Al Fayed.
Why did you, Mr.
Hamilton launched a libel action against The Guardian and dropped it at the last minute because he ran out of cash and not because he admitted the truth of the allegations. Sir Gordon Downey, Parliamentary Commissioner for Standards, was asked to investigate, and for the past 6 months he's been sifting documents and taking evidence. He's still writing his report, but it's said it'll be finished next week.
I believe that if this report was helpful to the government, they would be pressing every button, pulling every lever, and charging every door to get this report out. The fact that they're not doing so, I think, is very telling.
When Mr. Major went to the palace on Monday, the only surprise to emerge was that Parliament would be prorogued, that is, permanently suspended, this Friday, a whole fortnight before it formally ends in dissolution and the countdown to the election. At the time, it was seen simply as a way of getting his party's kamikaze tendency out of the public eye, but
like
not anymore.
To formally confirm that I've seen
He's left a longer gap between prorogation and dissolution than anybody has ever done, at least since 1918. He's in effect doubled the amount of time he's got. Now, nothing wrong with that. That gives you a long campaign. But what he's also done is ensure pretty effectively that what would probably have been a rather damaging report on the conduct of five or six of his own backbenchers will not now be published until after the election.
This is the most important report of all because it casts a slur over the future prospects of a number of members of Parliament. Surely, for their sake, if for nothing else, this report should be published and should be in the public arena immediately.
But others, like Tom King, who was on the Nolan Committee which recommended this new system of self-regulation, argue that publication of the Downey report is only part one of the inquiry.
Oh, but I think it would be monstrously unfair if the members themselves hadn't had a chance to have a look at it, make any representations, and for the proper procedure to take place. There are two alternatives. One is that the whole procedure could go through and a decision reached, and then the matter would be finished, and if people were guilty of offences, they would be received the appropriate punishment, and if they weren't guilty, they'd be clearly exonerated. They clearly believe, and Neil Hamilton's made this absolutely clear, that he believes he'd be totally exonerated. Either that happens, or the report at this stage quite clearly couldn't be published.
All evening in the Commons, MPs have been trying to devise a way of getting the report out. Appeals have been made to the Speaker, Commons motions tabled. They say where there's a will, there must be a way.
There is always a way around it. Constitutions such as ours are not written in stone. You can play all kinds of tricks with them. What the Prime Minister couldn't do is publish the report on his own authority because it's a report to Parliament, and that would be seen to be rather presumptuous, a bit like opening somebody else's letters. But at least a case could be made for saying that the committee itself should determine that even after prorogation, the report should be made available. It would be odd, but I think it would be just about getawayable with.
Then in the past hour, the Standards and Privileges Committee announced it will publish a partial report tomorrow.
We are very encouraged that at least some of these matters are going to come before Parliament as a result, undoubtedly, of the pressure of the past 36 hours. But of course, if any of this report comes to Parliament, then it only strengthens the case for the really serious issues which Sir Gordon Downey has been looking at also coming to Parliament before it prorogues.
As for the four MPs who've been giving evidence to Downey, Neil Hamilton, Tim Smith, Sir Andrew Bowden and Michael Brown, their fate will be decided either tomorrow or when the report's published in full after the election.
Well, that was Anne Perkins. I'm joined now by our political correspondent Nick Jones from Westminster. Nick, is this report that will be published, interim report they're going to be published tomorrow, is it going to be partly Downey or not at all Downey, just the committee itself's report?
Well, what we get the impression, certainly from talking to MPs, is that the committee have reached some conclusions, have made some decisions on some of the allegations. And as you heard in Anne Perkins' report, it's not just Neil Hamilton, there are those three other MPs. And the word certainly seems to be that perhaps the committee have decided, some MPs are actually going as far as saying they have decided to clear the other MPs because there has been some word from Sir Gordon about the other MPs, but not about the fundamental criticisms and complaints that have been made against Neil Hamilton. So the partial report could well look at the conduct of some of the other MPs who were caught up on the fringe of the investigation.
So, yeah, but can you be clear whether you think this is as a result of something they've heard about the Downey? They haven't seen the Downey report, have they?
No, that is right. They've not seen the central parts of the Downey report regarding Neil Hamilton. But clearly, there might well have been discussions, or there might well have been some indication of the position regarding the other MPs.
Okay.
That certainly is what we are hearing, that there will be a partial report about some of the allegations and their decisions on those allegations.
Nick, thank you very much for that. Well, now, the government was unable to provide us with the minister tonight, but we are joined by backbencher, Tory backbencher David Shaw, who joins us also from Westminster. Labour's Jeff Rooker helps to manage the Labour Party's business in the House of Commons, and Neil Hamilton, of course, at the centre of the allegations about what's called cash for questions. Now, Neil Hamilton, are you going to be satisfied? You've been pushing all day for the full Downey report to be published as soon as possible. Are you going to be satisfied with this so-called interim report from the committee itself?
Well, I'm sorry if I appear to be a little bit selfish, but at the moment I'm interested in myself. Naturally, I don't want to go into an election campaign with this issue unresolved. I've lived for 2.5 years with this stain on my character, this cloud over my head, and I want it to be dispelled.
But could this interim report have anything to say about you?
Well, I've no idea. Nobody tells me anything. It may well be the tip of the ice cube.
What do you understand, David Shaw, to be going on tonight? Have you any indication as to whether Nick Jones is right and whether this will help to clear perhaps some of the other MPs and have something or nothing to say about Neil Hamilton?
Well, I think we have to look back to the recent report that was done by Sir Gordon Downey on the totally false allegations against the cabinet minister, and that threw out the allegations by Mr. Mohammed Al-Fayed. And in consequence, we must question whether the allegations that have been made against other MPs are likely to stand up. And I would have thought all the likelihood is that they won't stand up. And therefore, I hope that the committee is going to publish, if possible, a report that will clear as many MPs as can be feasibly cleared.
But that's your judgment and your hopes and so on. Is there anything you understand that the committee can come up with in substance about the other MPs or about Neil Hamilton without having seen the Downey report?
Well, I hope that some of my hopes, which are being discussed in the corridors at Westminster, are based a little bit more on my personal hopes and, in fact, are a reality. And that is that the committee, as I understand it, is going to produce some form of report tomorrow, and hopefully that will be clearing a number of MPs, because that is the way the thrust of this has been going in the recent weeks.
And do you hear anything about the report doing anything to clear Neil Hamilton, or is it just the others?
Well, I think that we don't know. What we do know is that the committee's got a lot of outstanding work. It hasn't, for example, completed its work into the £2 million of blind funds involving Mr. Blair and other members of the Shadow Cabinet. And I hope that that will also be covered, because a number of select committees are actually giving out reports that are showing what their outstanding work position is. And I hope that the blind funds of Mr. Blair are going to be listed in the outstanding work position.
Well, now, Jeff Rooker, what does the Labour Party think about all this? Does it think that at the end of a rather confusing day, the government's come out of this and the committee's come out of this, of course, largely representing a government majority on the committee, with a rather sensible compromise or a sensible way forward?
No, I think we ought to get something out of the way. First of all, Sir Gordon Downey has thrown out completely David Shaw's complaints against
Jeff
Tony Blair's blind funds, but we're not here to discuss that. We're here to discuss the issue as to whether Parliament, being prorogued so early, is deprived of an opportunity for the committee to consider that report. MPs don't have to be present, it's just the committee. They can sit during the recess, and that's all we're asking for the prorogation period to be converted to a recess, so that Neil Hamilton and his colleagues can actually have the right to fight the election, refight their seats, in the full knowledge, from their expectation, of being cleared. Now, the report tomorrow, I would be astonished if it goes into detail, simply because the committee, that's the Standards and Privileges Committee, has not received a report from Sir Gordon Downey yet. Everybody knows, though, and knew some weeks ago, that would be ready by the end of this month. And that's why on Monday, people were quite astonished that prorogation came so early. And all we're asking for is the prorogation date just to be changed by a week, 10 days at the maximum. And that can be done quite easily by Her Majesty being asked to sign another piece of paper tomorrow with a different date on it.
David Shaw, why on earth could not the prorogation, which is going to last something like 2.5 weeks before Parliament's dissolved, why could that not be put back a bit?
These procedures are all laid down. Labour is aware of the procedures, and I think the fact that Labour is complaining shows that they're unfit to govern this country. They just have no idea.
Well, let's talk about the procedures. You say they're all laid down and so on, but I mean, our constitutional experts tell us that there is no earthly reason why you should prorogue Parliament for a whole 2.5 weeks before dissolving it.
No, because it would be grotesquely wrong for Parliament to continue. This Parliament has come to the end of its life. This Parliament has to conclude, and that is the principle on which every Parliament has operated. And also, many of us want to get out into the constituencies and do the work that we have to do in the constituencies.
Yeah, but we're talking about we're very specific 10 days or so.
Well, he could still do that. So could every MP, because we're not asking for Parliament to be sitting next week. If it was in recess, technically, the committees can receive the report and publish. But unlike most members of Parliament...
What Labour wants here is Labour wants political advantage because they're desperate, because the crime figures are falling. Unemployment is falling. And we are getting lots of successful messages across on the economy. And what Labour wants to do is try and focus on this issue, which is an outrageous thing for Labour to do, because they're frightened of facing the election on
real
issues.
Let's find out what Neil Hamilton thinks about all this. What do you think should be done? I mean, what would you like to see Mr Major do about this 2 weeks or so in which the Parliament will not be dissolved but prorogued?
Well, I'm the innocent victim here of two parties, really, because The Guardian refused deliberately to cooperate with Sir Gordon Downie during October and November last year, so he was 2 months late in starting. If it wasn't for the editor of The Guardian's refusal to cooperate, he could have reported 2 months ago. This problem wouldn't have arisen. I don't know whether the government realised what the impact of the prorogation period would have been on me. I don't suppose I come very high in the considerations of the government when it's got much more important things to take account of. But certainly the unfortunate feature of this, from my point of view, is that what I believe to be an exoneration on the main cash for questions issue is not now going to be available to me before the general election, which is obviously a very serious matter.
I heard you earlier today saying that although you insisted you weren't guilty of corruption, you admitted that you were guilty of errors of judgment. What were they?
Well, we're all guilty of errors of judgment in the course of our lives. And, of course, this has been much publicised in the newspapers over the last couple of years. There are various points to do with registration of interest. 10 years ago, the rules were much less explicit than they are
you
today.
You regret you didn't register interest more clearly.
Everybody knows about my stay at the Ritz Hotel in 1987, for example. And that was an issue which was discussed, decided upon by the Members' Interest Committee over 2 years ago.
Let's just establish for people at this important juncture whether or not you now say you received any cash to ask specific questions in Parliament.
No, this is a complete fantasy of The Guardian. They are publishing allegations by Mohammed Al-Fayed, including, for example, as David Shaw mentioned earlier on, that Michael Howard took £1 million bribe to appoint DTI inspectors.
Talking about you. I mean,
which Sir Gordon Downie dismissed as entirely groundless. This is but one of a whole web of allegations which he has made, which has mired members of the government, like Jonathan Aitken, myself, and other Conservative members of Parliament, which are completely
untrue. Apart from the £10,000, which you've already admitted to receiving from
that had nothing whatever to do with cash.
I understand. But apart from that, you received no other money in any connection from Greer Association.
I have received no other money. I have certainly not received any money for asking questions. I have produced to Sir Gordon Downie my own submission to the inquiry, which runs to 250 pages. I want this document to be published because in here, the real truth of this matter will be displayed to the public at large, the lies of Mohammed Al-Fayed and the turpitude of his willing assistants, the editor of The Guardian and his colleagues, much greater harm to the reputation of Parliament than anybody else in living memory has been responsible for.
Just one final point raised by Ian Greer last week. It was suggested that perhaps you didn't pay tax on the £10,000 you received, is that right?
I have paid tax on everything which is taxable, which I have received. And when Sir Gordon Downie's report is published, my response to all these allegations will be published with it. And I'm not going to discuss the evidence that I've given to Sir Gordon because I'm pledged by the rules on parliamentary privilege not to do so. But I'm perfectly sure that I have behaved entirely honestly and entirely properly in respect of everything.
Okay.
And
well,
as you know,
Neil Hamilton,
any allegation of impropriety or dishonesty against me.
Other people take very different views.
Well, other people don't know the facts, including yourself, right. Mr. Snow, if I may say so.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Jeff Rooker. Thank you, Neil Hamilton, and thank you, David Shaw. And a year after the government sounded the alarm, a possible link between BSE and animals and across the country by what they call the Prescott Express. Mark Bardell climbed aboard to see how Labour's veteran barnstormer was going down with the voters.
Oh, give me land, lots of land, under starry skies above. Don't fence me in.
From Bristol to South Wales to Dennis Potter country and then back to Bristol, the conscience of the Labour left intends his Round Britain tour to be a liberating experience, both for him and for the spin doctors.
Let me be by myself in the evening breeze and listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees.
Is Peter Mandelson here? In spirit.
Mr. Prescott is a hairy man. He does not like the architects of New Labour's soft words and smoothness. That's all right, they don't like him. A couple of months ago, I was talking to a Labour strategist and asked him what John Prescott would be doing during the campaign. He said, I don't really care, as long as he's as far away from London as possible. I thought he was joking, but John Prescott is going on a tour of the whole country, not coming back to the capital very much, and he's going to do 10,000 miles in the whole campaign. Is this really any way for New Labour to treat the man who's likely to be the next Deputy Prime Minister of Great Britain?
10,000 miles, all the key seat areas, many meetings, market stops, political shows, I'll be doing the lot, getting across to the people that Labour's got a real message and there's a fresh start, and that's what this is about, the Prescott Express.
You don't worry that some of your colleagues are shoving you out of the centre, out of the big press conferences in the morning?
Do you think anybody can shove me out of the centre? You must be joking. Go on.
During the last election, the then Shadow Transport Secretary was largely kept off the air. In one of his few appearances, he confessed that the minimum wage would cost jobs. That still echoes down the years to haunt Labour.
I think you have to accept there may be some shakeout in some of the jobs in certain areas.
He calls that honesty. They call it a stupid gaffe.
It may be that there are one or two faint-hearted spin doctors in the Labour Party who think that he's gaffe-prone or something like that. Personally, I think he's actually a tremendous campaigner. Probably the best campaigner that the Labour Party's got.
Come on, help you across, little old man.
Oh, God.
Help her across. Stop them cars. Stop them cars.
As much as actual gaffes, it's John Prescott's determination to have a bit of a laugh that gives some of his more straight-laced colleagues heart failure. His power base is among the traditional Labour supporters, and although his election tour is around marginal seats, today at least he wasn't allowed near a middle-class voter.
Does the dog bite?
John Prescott admits that traditional Labour supporters want reassuring. One person wanted to know why Tony wasn't keen on the unions. Another man wished Labour had stuck to some of its old policies.
Last elections, you did promise an £8 rise, I think, for every pensioner as soon as
you were trying to do. We said right away in the last election that what we said we wanted to do there was actually make up for the cut in the earnings. I think it was as much as about £12 then, and we offered the £8.
Yeah.
This time, we've moved on considerably from that. It's
now but does old Labour feel comfortable that they have moved on? A lot of people want more from Labour.
Well, of course they want more. I want to give a lot more. But in reality, they also say to us they want to actually give us realistic promises that we will deliver in 4 or 5 years' time. It is important in this programme to make real changes is over 2 election periods. So next time, whatever we promise this time, and we're cautious about what we promise, we fully accept that, we will deliver.
Opponents are very relaxed about the Prescott tour. They say it won't win the votes that count.
I think John Prescott will probably be welcomed in what are in reality old Labour areas, and he'll be viewed with trepidation in what might be regarded as new Labour areas. I don't see John Prescott as more than a consolidator of existing Labour votes.
I can understand the Labour Party sending him to Wales because they realise that the Tony Blair type of Labour Party is not relevant to the wishes of Wales or the values held by Labour voters in Wales.
I don't know what he would be if a disaster were to happen of a Labour government. I know we've got a very good Deputy Prime Minister at the moment who also does a lot to bring new jobs and investment into the United Kingdom.
At the end of this campaign, where will John Prescott's long journey end? His roots as a Seamen's Union leader reassures old Labour and means some highly placed supporters see him as the new Ernie Bevin, a rough, tough Foreign Secretary. Mr. Prescott himself once wanted to be the next George Brown, Deputy Prime Minister and heading an economic ministry rivaling the Treasury. Mr. Prescott now accepts that won't happen, but told me no deal has yet been done.
Then I hope I'll have played my part, certainly in the key seat strategy area, which I've been 2 years developing and seeing brought to fruition. Then there'll be a Labour government, then Tony Blair becomes the Prime Minister, and him and I will have a chat.
Mr. Prescott's supporters hope this tour will consolidate both Labour votes and his strong position among the membership. That would be his real power base in a Blair cabinet.
And that was Mark Mardell. And on last night's programme, we may have given the impression that the Transperience Museum in Leeds, which is in the hands of administrators, is to close. The museum's asked us to point out that this summer's programme events will be going ahead. A quick look at the papers, and the balance of reporting in the papers is three of them. The Telegraph, the Times and the Guardian go for the Sleaze report, and the Independent, the Financial Times, with them it's the Economy. A quick look at the rather nice picture on the front of the Mirror. There is Cherie Blair shaking hands with Norma Major in a rare meeting, and I'll leave the keys under the mat, is the Mirror's caption. Well, that's all for Newsnight tonight. I'll be back with more tomorrow night. Till then, from all of us on the programme, good night.